Hello everyone and welcome back to the continuation of the previous video where we were seeing how these weight matrices are defined for different deep learning ensemble method for uncertainty estimation. So we saw for deep ensemble it's basically creating as many copy of the network, so as many weight matrices, just they're initialized differently. For batch ensemble we'll have a shared weights, then for each ensemble member we'll define a rank one vectors. And from that, we are computing this weight for this ensemble member. And for the rank 1 BNN, it's similar to the batch ensemble. But here in the rank 1 vectors, instead of having just vectors, we'll have a distribution. So when I say distribution, instead of one value for each weight, we are going to have two values, one for the mean and one for the standard deviation. So now in this video, we are going to, whatever this theoretical understanding of weight matrices we have, we'll try to implement it and mathematically and compute the parameters for each of the layers with different ensemble method, and then also we'll implement the same in a code, and then we'll using Keras, and we'll see that the number of layer parameters that's appearing through the code and that's we counted are actually the same, and then convince us that we have a good understanding of how the weight matrices are defined for this three ensemble method. So let's get started. But before we get started, just a quick revision of how the computational units look in a neural network. So this is the computational unit in any neural network, no matter if it's a simple neural network or a fully connected neural network or a convolution neural network. The computation takes place like this. So we'll, in order to compute the output of one node, it will just multiply with whatever inputs are coming to the node with individual weights. So for instance, here three inputs are coming, so we'll multiply weight one with x1, weight two with x2, and there should be a plus here, sorry, and weight three with x3. And then on top of this, then we'll add a bias for every output node. So this is the fundamental computational unit that we follow. Now let's try to define it again for a fully connected neural network. So for a fully connected neural network, assume like this is one of the computational node. So how to count the number of parameters? So here the number of parameters will be equal to weights plus biases, and weights will be equal to the number of input unit, because every input unit is weighed by W, and then there is one bias for every node that we just saw. And the same logic is applied for this fully connected neural network, but here instead of say one node, we have multiple nodes. So we have to compute these values for multiple nodes. So how we can do that? So let's define some notation. So M is the number of input nodes and N is the number of output nodes. So the weights, for any layer, say for example this hidden layer, will be equal to N into M, because for one unit, we just saw it's equal to the number of inputs defined. But so for like three inputs, it should be three into the same values. So the weights for any hidden layer is going to be N into M. So if M is two and N there are three, then three into two, which will be like six, two for each of them. And then bias is equal to the number of output nodes, because there will be one bias for each output node. So because N is three, then the bias will be equal to three. And then the number of parameters is going to be weights plus bias, which will be, 6 plus 3 equal to 9. So for any hidden layer, this is the formula that we are going to use. If N is the number of output node and M is the number of input node, then the number of weights would be N into M, and bias will be equal to N, and the total number of parameters is going to be N into M plus M. Okay, so I hope this is clear. Just a quick revision. Now let's try to define one fully connected neural network with one input layer, two hidden layers with 50 units each, and one output layer. And let's try to compute the number of parameters for this. So first, so this is the formula that I've written for our reference. So first, for the hidden layer one, okay? So you can see here the input coming to this M is equal to one. So this is actually, connected to every other node. I'm just not showing it, okay? So n, so for the first layer, you know, m is equal to 1 and n is equal to 50. So weights will be, you know, simply 50 into 1. And bias will be equal to 50. So number of parameters for the first layer is, you know, 50 plus 50, which is 100. Now, when you come to the hidden layer 2, you'll see that the m has changed to 2. Sorry, m is changed to 50, n is 50. So the weights will be simply 50 into 50, which is 2500. And bias will be equal to number of output node, which is simply 50. So the number of parameters here is 2550. Okay. And the same for the output layer. Again, you see here m is 50, the number of input, you know, coming to this, and n is equal to 1, just one output nodes. So weights will be n into m, so 1 into 50, bias is 1, and number of parameters is 50 plus 1. So the total number of parameters for this network is simply, you know, adding up all three of this, so which will be like 2550 plus 151, so it's simply 1072. So the number of parameters for this network is 2701. Okay, now let's try to implement this in code and see, you know, that we get the same value. Okay, so the code is actually here at this GitHub. I will share the link. It's in a notebook, and also, you know, what you need to install. But for now, let's run it. So I'm going to import this, you know, these libraries to define our fully connected network. I'm defining ensemble size of 4. We'll not use this while defining the conventional MLP. So if you see conventional MLP, we define an input layer with one unit, and then based on the number of hidden layer, it's defining a function. We can create as many hidden layer with 50 hidden units, and then we have output layer, you know. And so let's define this model, and let's call this model. So you can see this summary, you know, of the network we define on the PPT. Two hidden layers, one input, one output, and you can see number of parameters, it's 2701. So it makes sense, you know. Now let's try to define this for a deep ensemble. Okay, so for deep ensemble, if you remember, it's the network is same, like for ensemble size 4, we have the four copies of the same network, but the only difference is that the initialization value of the weights will be different. So the parameter count, everything will be same. Okay, so if it's on you know, ensemble size 4, then you are going to have total number of parameters of 2701 into 4. Okay, which will be 408 and 42 16 18, approximately. No, it's 10804. Okay, so let's see in the code and how it is. So we just defined this you know, conventional model. Now to define the deep ensemble, I have created a function where we just pass in the ensemble size and the function that creates the model. Okay, and any hyperparameter like number of hidden units or something, and it's basically creates a list of models. Okay, but only difference, as I said, is the change in the initialization value. So if I run this and then I create this you know, create this call this deep ensemble function with two hidden layers, with each with hidden units 50, ensemble size of 4, let's run this, and you can see it's 4, so we count from 0, 1, 2, 3. So for member 0, the number of parameters is 2701. For member 1, again, you know, it's 2701. So it will be same number of parameters, member 2 and member 3 as well. And it is the same network, if you can see. Now, the number of parameters for this deep ensemble would be into the ensemble size. So it's basically 10,804. That's what we got even on the slide. And now let's try to convince us that, you know, the weights, the initialization values of different members of the model is different. So I am taking the, you know, weight 1 and weight 2 of ensemble member 0 and 1. And if you print it, you can see the weight value of ensemble member 0 and the weight value of ensemble member 1. So, you know, they are different. So the difference here lies in the initialization of the weights. The biases can be 0. But the weights value initialize are initialized differently. Okay, so this is the deep ensemble. Now let's move to the next approach of batch ensemble. So now let's look at the batch ensemble. So let's consider a same network with ensemble size 4, and let's see if this network was defined in, you know, batch ensemble format, then how the parameters count would be. So you know this is the formula for, you know, normal conventional MLP. And then there's one more point, like when in batch ensemble we are defining this rank 1 vectors for each of the ensemble member. And so basically the rank 1 vectors ri and si will have same dimension as the input and output. So ri will have the dimension same as input, that is m, and si will have dimension as output, that is n. Now we need to first define a shared weight, you know. So shared weight is our normal weight matrix for which is shared among all the ensemble member. So now let's actually just take the first layer. So this is the same network with one input node, 50 hidden layer here, 50 hidden unit here, and one output node here. Now if you just take the first layer, so we'll have m equal to 1, n equal to 50. So first let's define our shared weight. So our shared weight will be n into m, so w, which is 50 cross 1, which will be 50. Okay, and now for each of the ensemble members, so let's consider ensemble member 1. Okay, so we'll define a rank 1, a R1 and S1 vectors. So R1 will be equal to, you know, size of the input into, because it's just a rank 1 vector, so R1 will be equal to 1 into 1, and S1 will be output, which is n, which is 50, so will be 50 into 1. Okay, this is for the ensemble member 1, and same again for ensemble member 2. It's going to be R2 S2, which will be again 1 into 1 and 50 into 1. Okay, now this is the weight value. Now for each of the ensemble member we'll have bias as well. So the bias is simply equal to the number of output node. So bias of the ensemble member 1 will be 50, and bias for ensemble member 2 will be 50. Similarly for ensemble member 3 and ensemble member 4, you can see I have defined here for 1, 2, 3, 4. Now let's see what will be the number of weights for the ensemble member for the layer 1. So the total weights is going to be the shared weight, you know, the shared weight which we have, obviously, plus the weights which is added by each of the rank 1 vectors of the ensemble members. So it's going to be 1 plus 50, okay? So it's 50 plus 1, then it's going to repeat for, you know, the 4 ensemble members. So 50 plus 1, and then plus 50 plus 1, plus 50 plus 1, okay? So overall the weight is going to be, you know, it's 204 plus 50, 254, okay? And the bias will be simply for 4 ensemble member, 50 plus 50 plus 50 plus 50, so, you know, into 4, which is simply 200, and the overall weights then will be weights plus bias, which will be 454. Okay, so now this is interesting. It's easy. Let's see for this hidden unit 2, where we have, you know, 50 50, like a huge number of, so let me rub all this. Okay, come on. Okay, so it's taking some time. I don't want to change my slideshow mode. Okay, no problem. I think we are good. Okay, cool. Okay, now let's take for this you know, this layer when we are trying to compute the you know, weight for the ensemble members. So here m is equal to 50 and n is also equal to 50. So the shared weights, you know, as shared weights, which is w, which is going to be 50 cross 50, you know, this shared weight matrices. Now for ensemble member 1, you know, the R1 is going to be 50 into 1, and even the S1 is going to be 50 into 1. Okay, this R1 and S1. Okay, and then for this, the bias will be again equal to 50. So bias 1 is 50. Okay, and for ensemble member 2, ensemble member 3, ensemble member 4, it's all going to be the same. Okay, so you can see It's the same definition, just there's a different different weights. So for again R2 S2, R3 S3 will be 50. Now if you combine these total weights, you know, so weights will be going to be equal to shared weights first, so which is 2500, okay, plus this, the weights defined here into 4, so it's going to be, you know, 25 so it's going to be 50 plus 50, which is 100, so it's going to be 100 into 4, okay, so the weights is going to be 2900, and the bias will be 50, like for one ensemble member bias is 50, so simply 50 into 4, which is equal to 200, so the number of total weights for this layer is going to be 3100, okay. And the same for you know, output layer, you can define the rank 1 vector. R1 will be like 15 to 1, S1 will be simply 1 into 1, and bias will be 1, you know, because there's just one unit n. And same for ensemble 2, 3, 4, and you can compute the weight. Now total number of weights for this layer when we define this batch ensemble, it's going to be 3100 plus 454 plus 258, which is going to be 8, 4, 12, 2, and then 10, 11, 1, 4, 2, 6, 2, 8, so it's going to be 3812. Okay, now let's implement this batch ensemble in code and see that we get same number of outputs. So for this batch ensemble and other, you know, probabilistic models, Edward library in TensorFlow is really good to define all this kind of layer. So I'm using this Edward library, and you can see I just simply imported Edward library, and they have the, you know, options to directly define this dense layer with the batch ensemble logic. So here you just need to give the number of hidden units the way you give, the rank, which is 1 for us, the ensemble size, whether to use bias or not, and then the initializer for your, you know, the alpha and gamma, the rank 1 vectors. So here this sign initializer is used. So in the official uncertainty baseline from Google repo, they are using this. That to initialize these layers, they're using random sign init. So I'm just using this function to initialize it. So this is your, you know, batch ensemble dense layers, and then output layer is again a dense batch ensemble layer. This is the hidden layer, and then we define the model, and that's all. Okay, so we are just simply using you know, the layers from the Edward library. So I'll just call this function and let's see. So I'm calling this model.batchEnsemble with hidden units 2, or hidden layer 2 and hidden units 50. Let's run it. So you can see the number of parameters is 3812, and that's what we also computed from our computation. And you can see the number of parameters each layer. So input layer, yeah, there's nothing. For the batch, for the layer 1, it was 454, and the way we computed, you know, it's actually right, it's 454, where we define rank 1, S1, bias, and, you know, we do it for all the 4 members along with the shared weights. So remember, we'll have a shared weight plus the weights coming from each ensemble member, okay? So, and if you see this, then it's 454, and for layer 2, we also computed 3100, and for layer 3, you know, the output layer, we computed 258. So, you know, whatever logic we have the understanding of is actually correct. Now, let's move to the rank 1 BNN, the last one. Now, if you remember the rank 1 Bayesian neural network, so here we define Bayesian neural network by, you know, defining distribution only over the rank 1 vectors. So it is similar to the batch ensemble, just that instead of point estimate, now we'll have distribution. And for each of this value now, you know, this distribution will be represented by 2 values. Okay, remaining all the computation would remain same. So let's take the same network of input layer 1, hidden 50, 50, and 1. And let's try to define a rank 1 BNN through this. So again, if you see the, let's try to do it for the first layer. So here if you'll see like m is equal to 1, n is equal to 50. So we have to first define our shared weights. So which is going to be n into m, which is, you know, shared weight, it's simply 50 into 1. And for each of the ensemble member, like ensemble member 1, we have to define, you know, the rank 1 and s1 vectors. Now ri will be sharing the same value as input and si will be sharing the same value as output. So here, yeah, actually this should be ri should be 1 into 1, sorry for that, and si should be 50 into 1, but anyhow the computation won't change. So if you see for this value, what we have to define, that we have to define the rank 1 vectors, but instead of one value we have to define two values. But simply, first of all, let's define, you know, the R1 as simply 1 into 1, which is 1, and S1 as 50 into 1, which is 50. And then the bias for this, you know, bias is, you know, simply equal to number of output, which is bias 1 will be equal to 50. Now, if you see, if you want to have a distribution for ri and si, then this should be in, for every value there should be two values. So simply do into two, so one for mu and other for sigma, so it will become 2. And again, if you do 2, it will become, you know, 100. Okay, so if you see here, I have defined simply, first of all, I've simply defined for ensemble member 1 the normal weights, for 2 the normal weights 3 and 4, and here I'm simply adding, I'm doing into 2 for each, for the weights, for each of the ensemble member, for each of the weights I'm doing into 2, but simply it's totally fine. So for each of the rank 1 vector for R1 and S1, we'll have two values for one unit. Okay, now if you see for ensemble member 1, what will be the, so first let's do the share total weights, you know. So first we'll have the shared weights, which is 50, then plus the weights of the ensemble member 1, which is 2 plus 100, which is 102, and this will be into 4 times for each of the ensemble member. So this will come around 404 plus 50, it will be like 454. Okay, and then the biases will be simply like for one ensemble member it's 50, so 50 into 4, which is equal to 200, which is 200, yeah. So the total weights will be 454 plus 200, 654. That's what we have computed. What, 658? Oh, sorry, I did a mistake here, it will be 408, so it will be 458, sorry, and it will be 658. Okay, so now you got the idea. So just the change is here in the rank 1 and S1. For each of the rank 1 and S1 vector, you have to multiply into 2 because we are trying to define a distribution. Okay, and that's what I am doing here. Like instead of doing it here, I am just doing at the end. Okay, into 2 of this. Now I can also show a straight away comparison and you can see the difference. So this is the input layer of the batch ensemble and this is the rank 1 BNN. And you can see it's, yeah, again, it's a mistake here. R1 will be 1 into 1 and S1 will be 50 into 1. So you will see it's, everything is same, just that in the weight value, you know, weights alone for each of the ensemble member, it's into 2. Okay, and here it's not into 2, like, you know, that's all is the difference, you can see. Okay, now if we go back here and try to do the same thing for the second layer, just to convince ourselves. I'll just quickly rub this. Okay. Okay. Cool. Okay. So here again, M is 50, N is 50. So I'm doing it for the second layer. And then the shared weights, W is going to be 50 into 50, which is 2500. And let's compute for ensemble member 1 and we'll do into 4. So for ensemble member 1, the rank 1 is going to be 50 into 1, R1, sorry, S1 is going to be again 50 into 1 because both M and N are 50. But now because we are doing rank 1 BNN, this will be like into 2. So it will become 100 and this will also become 100. And the bias, because N is 50, is going to be 50. Now, if you do total weights, it's shared weights, which is 2500 plus the rank 1 weights, which will be 100 plus 100, 200 into 4, which will be 800, which will come around 3300. And then the bias is simply 50 into 4, which is 200. And the total number of parameters will be this plus this, which will be 3500. Okay, now let's implement this in the code and see that we get the same values. So again, for defining rank 1 BNN, I am going to use the Edward library. And actually, it's not very straightforward to define this layer, because you need to define this distribution, you know, based on some theoretical understanding and all. So I'm not going into the definition of it. We're just seeing, you know, how the weight matrix is defined. So I have taken this code logic from this uncertainty baseline official repo. And to define the layers, you can just have a look. So what is happening here is we are defining some initializer function, okay? And then we are defining based on the initialization function and, you know, some prior mean and standard deviation, like we're defining the prior distribution. There are some KL divergence and all. Let's not look into that for now. So we are defining simply our hidden layers with the hidden dense layer with the rank 1 BNN. So it's directly provided by the library Edward. So we're defining the units, we're defining the initializers, you know, the R and S along with some regularization parameters. And, you know, because it's going to be a distribution, we need to define this mean and standard deviation for the distribution. And in this way, we define a dense layer. And then if we define the output layer by calling this dense rank BN1, and we can simply run this. Let me run the initializer function first. Okay, and then we are calling the rank 1 BNN with two hidden units, each with 50. And if we run this, so we get a total parameter of 4620. And we didn't add it up, but if we add it 3500, it will be like 4500 plus. Okay, we'll do it here. But let's check the first layer. So it was 658, and as per, you know, what we computed, it is 658. And for second layer, we just computed it's 3500. Here itself also it is 3500. Okay, so I think now you got the idea of how this, you know, parameters are computed for all deep ensemble, batch ensemble, and rank 1 BNN. Now let's do the parameter comparison, okay? Because we want to see, like, as the ensemble size increases, you know, how which of the model becomes more parameter efficient. So I'm defining a plotly function to plot this. So I'm plotting, you know, the graph for deep ensemble, batch ensemble, and rank 1 BNN. So I'll just call this helper function for now. So we'll do it by increasing the number of hidden units so that we will see, you know, we'll have the hidden units 50, and we'll vary the number of layers from 1 to 10 to see as the network gets bigger, how it has the impact on the parameter size. Okay. So I'm just keeping a list to store the parameter count for each of this variable hidden layer. I'm looping over and calling, you know, the conventional model, the ensemble model, the batch ensemble, and the rank 1 BNN. And then in order to count the increase of parameter, you know, we are comparing with this number of when the, you know, model was when the single model was defined, and when we define an ensemble, we divide it just to get the ratio of how much percentage, or, you know, how, by what factor it increases. So if I run this, you know, for hidden layer 1 to 10 for hidden units 50, it will take some time, and I'll also run the plots so we can see. I'm waiting a few seconds. Yes, so you can see for a hidden unit 50 and varying the layers from 1 to 10, these are the parameters for a single model, for deep ensemble model, for batch ensemble, for rank 1. And if you see parameter increase, so for deep ensemble, it's simply going to be into the ensemble size. So we have a 4, so the parameters is going to increase 4 times. Okay, for batch ensemble, if you see, when we have just one hidden layer, the increase is more than deep ensemble. But as I said, as the number of layers increases and no more number of parameters increases, you can see the increase is just by a factor of 1.4, 1.3, 1.2, 1.2, and so on. And even for the rank 1 BNN, for just hidden layer 1, obviously the increase is more. But as the number of hidden layer increases, you can see the by the factor which this rank 1 BNN ensemble increases, the parameter count is just 1.4. Now you can also see it in the graph. So you can see this is for the deep ensemble, no matter what the hidden number of hidden layer is, it will increase it by a factor of the number of ensemble size. But for batch ensemble and rank 1 BNN, you can see that, you know, the as the number of layers increases, you know, we get a factor of just 1 point something, 1.2, 1.4 as compared to 4. So in terms of parameter, batch ensemble and rank 1 BNN are quite efficient. Now we can also see for a bigger model like a hidden unit 500 and varying this layer, you know, again from 1 to 10, and we can see what by what factor the parameter increases. We have to wait for a while. Yes, so you can see again that parameter increase for deep ensemble is always, you know, into 4 of what was for the single model. It will be simply into 4 for batch ensemble. Yeah, it will be into 4 for one hidden layer, but you know, now it's 1.0 1.0, and for rank 1 BNN also it's, you know, 1.0 1.0 1.0. if you simply see in the graph, then yeah, after once the, you know, model increase having layer more than 2, you can see they're almost increasing very less by a factor of just 1.0, you know, so 1.04, it's like just 4%, you know, point 1.04, so just by a factor of additional 0.04, and here 0.05. So yeah, from the parameters perspective, I think the batch ensemble and rank 1 BNN are, you know, quite close to each other. Very small difference, and they're not increasing that much as compared to the deep ensemble. So this can be considered when you are, you know, implementing and you have this constraint of model size. Then maybe we may not go for deep ensemble and we can go for batch or rank 1 BNN. But if you see from the implementation perspective, for the deep ensemble you need not change anything, but for batch and, you know, rank 1 BNN, you have to change the layers and all. So you have to just see the trade-off and implement accordingly. So I think, yeah, that's all. From here I think you got a good idea of how the parameters are defined for, you know, all these different models. We also computed mathematically all these parameters for you know, simple MLP model, and then we also, you know, verified everything through the code. I hope you learned something, and I will share the code, I will share this slide as well in my GitHub repo, so you can, you know, use it. And then thank you very much. Keep learning, take care, and keep exploring neurons. Bye.